I will speak a bit about segregation from different perspectives, and there will be examples from Stockholm, Gothenburg, the Shared City Project, the Let's Start. Some of you were involved by that time. And a few slides from Uppsala, where we are doing some stuff right now. So urban segregation normally, or the most traditional way of discussing and talk about segregation, is as residential segregation. And then we get to all these problems. How should we, maybe Lars and Meta has already been there, defining an area? How do we define an area? How do we define a category that is relevant for our research questions? So in a project, we tried to look at other perspectives on segregation. And segregation is about separation, a separation of people, or a separation of activities and functions. So by widening the perspective, we can talk about urban segregation in many different ways, and also investigate it from many different perspectives. So what we have, and how is this then related to urban design and architecture? So moving from those geographical descriptions that actually ignores where the street network is, it ignores density, it ignores its relation to the inner city or to all other areas or neighborhoods. We could actually start and take into account more how the street network is configured, the buildings, the people, and not least, what is most interesting in space and place analysis, the relations that are created between either buildings, peoples, amenities, functions, economic activities, or whatever. And to put this, trying to highlight what the difference is, this is after Donald Cox sitting here, the way of describing or give this narrative that it is a distribution in space, of space, and through space. And in space, that's what we normally, I'm sorry that they're a bit light, but it's a compromise here for the light. Where do we have, for example, workplaces? This happens to be Södertälje. So this is the location in space. But it doesn't really say so much of how accessible they are. And what affordances could we get from that? And then we can look at the distribution of space. That says something, how space is connecting these different functions in a city. And then if we add more things like where do people live, where are the houses, and through space, using the street network, and either through metric distance or turns or whatever, how accessible are these? So this gives one idea and one understanding of Södertälje and the workplaces. But if we look at this one, we can see that some areas have much higher access to workplaces. That is very important for the chances to get a job today and chances in the labor market. And we can see then how the 4 million homes program areas actually have quite low access. The job banana that has been described as. And to talk a bit about co-presence, the importance of co-presence, that we share the city, and not only for drinking coffee and nice people sitting out, especially now in May, everyone just says, here in Sweden, lovely to sit there, but there are more important reasons. Because there are a lot of social networks that could be created, weak ties, strong ties. We get an awareness of other people's living conditions, their identity of city. Who's the Gothenburger? Who do I meet in the street every day? Who do I not see? And that actually has an effect upon many different things. So how easy is it to meet my neighbors? How easy is it to meet other people from the neighborhood? And not least, how easy is it to meet people from other neighborhoods, from the city as a whole? And where are the places where we can gather? Some people like the very, very intense places, but some people also like a bit more of space. Otherwise, you can't really meet up with this kind of club here. And some small spaces is just that we can meet over generations. These two old ladies, they met here every day. They hardly knew their names, but they like met here every time they were shopping. And that's also, they're contributing to the local urban life here. And you can see and share and exchange. You don't have to talk to each other necessarily, but you're exchanging a lot of other information. And some places are really crowded. And how do we decide for that? You can look in any plan, it's like, we want more crowded places. But do we want more crowded places everywhere? And if we want that, how do we design for crowded places? Or how do we design for more places like this? And what do we do if we want to change something? So by understanding a bit more what kind of urban properties, configurative properties that are actually encouraging both the intensity but also encouraging a mix, if that is what we're after. We did a study of 18 squares in Stockholm, asked them a lot of things, and we do have a lot of data in Sweden, but we don't really know how people use the streets, the squares, and everything, so we have to ask them. Now we have no boxes, so we'll see how that goes. And that's a different kind of data set, and that's also interesting. What kind of knowledge could we get from this way? Getting talking to people, asking them all this, how often are you here, how old are you, why are you here, what do you like in the data, and most important, where do you live? So we can get that kind of social catchment area for each square, for each place in the city, and trying to start to understand what kind of configurative properties that is actually making this mix happen. If we take these 18 squares in Stockholm, we found that many had a lot of inflow. They have a high share of people coming from other areas. And the pedestrian flow corresponded quite well to that. So we can see that intensity is also something that corresponds to the mix. So if we want quiet and peaceful areas, how do we design for them? And if we want more intense areas, how should we design for them? So looking at these specific cases, we have one area with mostly dominated by locals, and in the other end we have, or it was not actually, we have other cases, other outliers also, but this one where we have few locals. What kind of urban life can happen here? What kind of exchange? And talking about cohesion, or other things, it's important to see to what extent we can mix. And then we come down to more detailed things. This is two different squares. So the orange dots were at the red square, and the blue dots visited the other square A. Maybe even it was Sara and Lars was there talking and interviewing people. And so why don't they mix? Why don't they go to each other's squares? So we have a residential segregation that is quite strong here. These are classified as deprived areas, but it's also, on top of it, reflected in the use, how we use the city, and in the public life. And we can look at the architecture. This is the images of the main path. And I don't know if you were an architect. Is this how you would design the main path? So we can go to the very, very details. What do I want people to understand through my design? So we have representative aspects and functional aspects. It's not enough just to have a link. It also depends what we want to communicate with that link. And of course, we can look at the spatial catchment area. It looks very, very different. They're not even friends. These two, they have spatially two completely different catchment areas. So here it's design for separation. Urban design is encouraging segregation. So how many of these areas can we have in a city without having a strong polarization? And if we want to change that, we actually have to do something with the urban layouts. We can also look at density. I guess Meta has gone through a lot of it. This is access to people, both working people and living people, because that's also a point. We need to widen, and not only talking about residents, but also talk about the working population. And it's overlaid with the betweenness, centrality. So we can see the width of these different, how high they are, how net, how dense the net is, or how wide it is. And we could come up with methods, how to compare. All these analyses are made on an address point level, very, very local, but we can aggregate them and start comparing different areas. So this is one method developed for comparing different neighborhoods. These are the 18 squares, the potential for a mix and an intensity of urban life. And then we can see which one we would like to start with, or the more they are filled, the better potential. So what about the equal living condition? This was only one aspect, the urban life. What kind of resources, what kind of amenities do I get from neighbors or other people in the city? What kind of social networks can I develop? But we also have these very like basic amenities, other aspects. And we started this project in Gothenburg, and they had this investigation about unequal living conditions. And the first question we asked, there was Lars and Meta was involved in that one also. Well, okay, but how does it look today? To what extent does Gothenburg have unequal living conditions that are influenced by urban design and architecture? So most of the investigations were about people, socioeconomic aspects, status. But if you go to the built environment, how can you be favored or misfavored depending on where you live? How can we design and distribute resources through planning, through architecture, for making some areas more easy to live in, or otherwise other areas that could be more disfavored? So we started to do quite a lot of mapping, because it didn't exist by then, and what kind of properties that were available. And just looking at the year now, I can see it's time for another round and see what has happened. And what we looked at were different aspects that we found important for everyday life. That could be health centers, schools, playgrounds, youth centers, some kind of basic amenities, basic services. And then some things we also thought, well, it's not really interesting to see where is the closest culture house. Maybe it's more interesting to see how many culture activities are found. So on the top, it's like 1-to-1, minimum distance to something. And the lower ones, we thought, these are amenities that we want to know a bit more, how many. So we started to do a lot of these kind of investigations. It could be playgrounds. And then we can discuss, so what do we mean by doing this? We have actually distributed the resources. Why do we put playgrounds in some areas and not in others? If we should overlay this, we started to overlay where there were, for example, very overcrowded apartments. Could be relevant to have more playgrounds or a socioeconomic aspects. And then you can see where it's troublesome that we have, for example, very few playgrounds or very few healthcare centers. So all of these different things, and it was also the spatial properties that we know are correspond to certain things. But it could be, oh, I can see it's missing on the top. It's income, unemployment, workplaces. So access to people that has a job, access to people without a job, to the workplaces per se. And then, of course, these kind of spatial configurative analysis. And here we also aggregated them. And for the politicians, we also sum them up to a figure. So it becomes very easy. 7, 7 point, 8 point, 6 point, 6 point, 6 point. So it's very easy to understand. Bad, good, need more help, need more support, direct more resources, investment go this way. So it could be very easy. But what we found out here was that they were rather similar. This was the minimum distance. And no wonder, there are more, most of them are designed according to the neighborhood unit model. One of each thing, and close to. But when we came to these, what kind of things there were many of, then they started to perform very differently. So here we definitely had another image of these areas. So then we have only 1 point for Gordian, or 6 points for Shirpin, and combining that with the socioeconomic situation, it could be rather difficult when we find these kind of conditions in Gordians, for example. There is one area that has people with fewer resources. So that is a way how architecture and urban design actually can be used as a mean to change things and make these areas coming better out and easier to live in, making all these everyday life activities. What we discussed here was starting also to discuss more about presence of society. We talk about a lot about exclusion, integration on the one hand, and exclusion, but excluded from what? What is there? How can society be visible in these different areas? You often read that, okay, now they're closing the library, they're closing this school, and it's not only that the library disappears, it's also a symbol for society at large. It's a kind of representative for society in that area. And we also discussed a lot about the schools. What about the schools being placed very deep in the structure? Now, you know, you talked about depth, or very far away, not on the first row, so to say. So far away, hidden away, segregated in the structure. And what does that say? Is that not important? Or we don't just pass it. So looking at the, with this lens at different areas, we say, okay, you should shop in this area. And you can go biking, because it's easy. You can get rid of your bike. Oh, here we're interested in culture. You can go to the cinema. What do we place just at the square, at the most integrated parts, on the first row? That is something that we find as a society that is important. Culture. Presence of culture. This is from another project where Daniel and Essen was here just before also, and we were developing for the Commission for Social and Sustainable Stockholm, investigating presence of culture, accessibility to culture. And this is, of course, very, what does it make to us if we walk here every day passing this? I can sit down and get it very in a kind of by the way thing. I get some kind of architecture, I get culture. What does it mean? But we widen a bit and we say that it has to do with many other things. To have the opportunity to do things, what kind of urban environment the places do we need for that? To perform for each other, not in a huge scene, maybe alone. Or be among others, to participate in different things, or to do things, or making places your own. So this was a model how we studied Stockholm and studied the inequalities in terms of presence of culture, but also from a democratic point of view. So having a library means access to societal information, access to a place to sit and be, and get information, and many other things. We have continued with that work now in Uppsala, Gottsunda, that is many people describe as one of the deprived areas with a lot of problems right now. And we worked very closely to the planning office in this case. So during the last year we've been with them, and they've been working with these programs. And what they have actually, they like this about societal presence. So in the first draft, in 6 pages of their policy document, it was, we found the word 6 times. There was 6 pages. So yes, they liked the idea. So we said, now we really need to deepen the understanding, so we really know what is this about and how can we use it. And it's important that we further develop these ideas. So they say focus in physical urban development is contributing to increased safety and well-being. A continuous city and neighborhood. Very common nowadays, isn't it? Urban life and increased societal presence. So, what is societal presence in Gottsunda? And what is the continuous city? How do we create that? Well, taking the main path down, you find a symbol for religion, there it is, church. You can see the library, there is a school with very good results, Kulturpunkten, culture meeting place, and this is placed within a huge shopping mall. So just walking one street in Gottsunda, society tells you, go shopping, go to church, go and read a book and do some activities and educate yourself. So you, in a sense, very easily. Well, but it's placed there. These things are placed in the first row. So what else do we need in other positions? And how can we play with this in architecture and urban design and have a more conscious way of actually locating things in a neighborhood? So looking at this very specific examples at school, schools is a symbol for education. How important is that? And it's also representing society. People can meet in the school in the evenings and have their meetings or whatever, and there are other activities there. We just passed this school on the way. This is not Gottsunda, this is Rosendal. And this says a bit about how important is the school. Back then, and today, how much effort do we put in the architecture for these kind of buildings? Do we still think education and our children, are they important in our society today? What does it tell us when we go to this school every day? This is where you should learn things. And what does it tell you? This is the old school. So how is the experience to go to this school or this school? I don't know. But it says something about how society looks upon education and environments for children. Here are some other schools in Uppsala. So we started to think about how are they placed over time. Looking, how did we place the school 100 years ago, and where are they placed over time in different positions in the urban context? So, back again. Distribution in space. If we just look at where they are, these are preschools and the elementary schools, the green dots. We can already here see that the preschools are a bit deeper in the structure, a bit more segregated, perhaps more close, and they are more spread out. Could be a logic in that. And the other schools are more located at the first row, so to say. We also added parks and libraries because they are very much connected and people move a lot between these, after school and so on. And looking at the distribution of space, we also discussed a lot with the planning people. They said that this was the most segregated area because that is a million home program area. And we were like, yes, but the structure says something else here. So it's also very important to actually look. All Million Homes programs are not in place. They may have a structure that is completely different. Please look first before you say something about it. And this affects actually the distance, the access to the schools. Here is metric distance and here are terms. And also just comparing them could say something about orientation in this area. If we want them to be more present, maybe it's not always the metric distance. Maybe it's how close they are the main core system. So continuing that thought of idea, these are the ideas they have how they want to develop the main paths in Gottsunda. And this is very much reflecting the car street network. And here we can see that they want to integrate the different parts, but still they don't do very much. They don't propose anything to actually interleave them. So on one hand, they say something in the text, but the translation, maybe you talked about that, Lars, translation to urban form, it wasn't really a match between these. So looking at the core, the integration core of this area on the local level, on the global level. And let's see now how this, these are the main path. So this is also, if you use the main in the main core, the most centrally streets, what do you get presented from this area? What could be your impression? And if we add now, how are the schools located in relation to this very central core system? Well, we can see that most of them are actually at the first row, and we can see that some are distant. So if you want to make a change here, if you want to have more presence, if you want these schools to be more present in the neighborhood as such, you can start working with it very precisely. You don't have to do very much here. You just have to keep this. You should not take away that one. But on the other hand, you can do things with the other schools. And we can also start to try to combine and see a pattern of these areas, arenas, that are important for children. So we did a test between the preschools to do attraction between us, if you have talked about different methods here. And so which paths actually link the different preschools? And expanding this also to parks and libraries and other points there where maybe the children need to go in certain sense. You can highlight the streets that are important for moving around in this area where kids perhaps need to be. And then you can look at the street and how it's divided, are there sidewalks and all kind of these questions for going on in the design process. Okay, that was it.